Hello, mathletes. I'm Matt, and today we are going to be working on number 15 from page 170 of our Nelson Advanced Functions textbook. And we will be working with division statements throughout this question. So the question asks us, if the divisor of a polynomial f at x is x minus 4, then the quotient is x squared plus x minus 6, and the remainder is 7. So let's get started with part A, and that's to write the division statement. Now we know that our division statement is the divisor multiplied by the quotient plus the remainder, and that is all equal to our original equation f at x. Now we've been given our divisor, our quotient, and our remainder. So our divisor up here is x minus 4. Our quotient is here, x squared plus x minus 6. And our remainder, which is 7. So we just rewrote our division statement, subbing in the values given to us in the question for the divisor, the quotient, and the remainder. And we sub them in to this formula. Now we've got to solve for f at x to give us our full solution. Now we're going to do that by expanding and simplifying equation that we have here. So let's start by using the distributive factor to get rid of these brackets. And that will leave us with x cubed plus x squared minus 6x minus 4x squared minus 4x plus 24 plus 7. And that's all equal to f at x. And now we are just going to simplify this down with our like terms. And that will give us our final answer of f at x. So this simplifies down to x cubed minus 3x squared minus 10x plus 31, and that's all equal to f at x, or our original function. And now we are going to, for the final step, we're going to take this part of the division statement, and this went our f at x, our original equation, and we're going to write it all out together to create our full division statement. So let's do that. We've got our divisor, which is x minus 4, multiplied by our quotient, which is x squared plus x minus 6, and adding our remainder, which is 7, and that is equal to f at x, which we solve for here is x cubed minus 3x squared minus 10x plus 31. And that is our final answer for question A. All right, let's move on to part B. Part B asks us to rewrite our division statement by factoring the quotient. And our division statement from last time was x minus 4 multiplied by x squared plus x minus 6 plus a remainder of 7. And that was all equal to f at x, which we won't need during this part of the question, so I'm not going to spend the time to write it out. So let's look at what the question asks us again. Rewrite the division statement by factoring out the quotient. So this is our quotient here, x squared plus x minus 6, and we are just going to simply factor it out. It's a simple trinomial, and it's really not that difficult. And then at the end of the problem, we are going to sub our factored form of this back in to create something that's starting to look like the factored form of this function. So we're gonna factor this out. X squared plus x minus 6 is equal to x minus 2 times x plus 3. And that's our our quotient has now been factored. So now we're going to sub it back in for our quotient, and that will give us our new division statement. So let's go ahead and do that. So we've got x minus 4 times x minus 2 times x plus 3 plus our remainder from above, which is 7, is all equal to our original function f at x. And there you go. That's part B. Part A is write the division statement. Part B is rewrite the division statement by factoring the quotient. And part C is to graph f at x using your results from part B. All right, so let's get started on C, which is to graph f at x using our results from part B. Now, in part B, we came out with an equation that looks like the factored form of f at x, or close to it, and that gave us x minus 4 times x minus 2 times x plus 3 plus a remainder, which was 7, and that is all equal to f at x. Now, we know that our zeros here are going to be at positive 4, positive 2, and negative 3. But what does this value here do, this remainder? It's actually the vertical shift for our function. And it's just going to take this function and we'll push it all up by 7 units and we'll have our full function f at x. So I'm going to go ahead and draw my graph. All right, and now we can plot our zeros. All right, so based on the equation above, we know that we have a 0 at positive 4, we have a 0 at positive 2, and we have a 0 at negative 3. Now we got those values from up here. So let's solve for our turning points. So we know that our turning points are going to happen right in the center between two zeros, which for this one here is going to be negative 0.5. And we are going to have another turning point right here at positive 3. So right now we're solving for f at negative 0.5, which we know is equal to 0.5 minus 4 times negative 0.5 minus 2 times negative 0.5 plus 3. And that is going to give us negative 4.5 times negative 2.5 times positive 2.5. And that is going to give us 28.125. So we just got the point up here. It's going to be 28.125, which is going to be right up here, close to the 30. And now we can solve for our second turning point, which is going to be down here somewhere. So let's plug in our points again. F at 3 is equal to 3 minus 4 times 3 minus 2 times 3 plus 3. And that is going to give us negative 1 times 1 times 6. And that is going to give us negative 6. So our point down here is going to be negative 6. And now we can pretty much draw our graph. It's going to look something like this. And now all we need to do is shift our this graph here up by 7, because our remainder is 7 here. And we're going to draw this new graph, our final graph in red. So adding 7 to 28.125 is going to give us 35.125, which is going to be right up here. And when we add 7 to our turning point here, it's going to give us a new turning point at 1. And then we can do the same thing with our zeros. We're just going to add 7, which is going to put them right up here, and up here at 7, and again up here at 7. And now we can draw our new and final graph, which is going to look something like this. And that is question 15 from page 170 of your Nelson Advanced Functions textbook. I'm Matt, and thank you for watching. Polynomial functions and equations are very useful in engineering when it comes to race cars, and whether it's F1 or rally cars or drag cars, the object is to create a power curve or a torque curve that maximizes the efficiency of the car over the length of the race. So engineers that are on race teams would work with polynomial functions to create a power curve that is going to benefit their team in a race. You can see this in dyno tests. A dyno is something that measures the power of a car, and race teams will spend a lot of time on a dyno, which will measure the power curve and the torque curve of the race car.